This webinar is brought to you by the Pilot Information Center. If you have any general aviation questions, or perhaps a specific question regarding this webinar, or for that matter, assistance with medical certification or AOPA's products online, you can contact us with your questions at 800-872-2672. That's 800-USA-AOPA, Monday through Friday, 8:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Or you can email us your questions as well at pilotassist@aopa.org. Before we get started, I'd like to remind our viewers that you can subscribe to our AOPA YouTube channel by using the subscribe button. Also, during the live presentation, you can send us your questions in the chat box just to the right of the video. I will be answering the most popular questions and monitoring your chats at the end of this hour-long presentation. Joining us today are Mike Filucci and Dave Hirschman.
Hi, Ferdy.
Hi there. Mike is AOPA's Vice President of Flight Operations and Pilot Information Center, and is a Warbird Formation flying pilot, instructor, and evaluator, as well as a former board member for FAST. And we'll talk a little bit more about FAST shortly. Mike, thanks for being here.
It's my pleasure, Dave.
Also with us is Dave Hirschman. Dave is an AOPA editor at large in our media department who helps organize and participates in air-to-air photo missions, among other forms of formation flying for our magazines and videos as well. Hi there, Dave.
Hey, pretty good. Glad to be here.
Glad to have you all both, yeah. And what is interesting to mention with these two gentlemen is we have two experienced formation pilots presenting this episode, but they come from different formation flying backgrounds. Dave comes from the civilian arena and Mike from the military side, and yet somehow they're able to fly formation together compatibly, no less, right?
Amazing as it sounds.
It's not as much apples and oranges as it sounds like. All right, let's get started. As part of our registration process for this webinar, we sent out a link to a survey asking registrants a few simple questions in order to gauge the needs of our audience. As of a short while ago, we had about 460 respondents. 61% of those respondents said that they have flown in formation, meaning that 39% have not. The majority of respondents, about 40%, said that their formation training was self-taught. Another 23% said their training was learned in the military, 14% through an aircraft type club, and 24% said other. Many of those were things such as, I flew with an instructor and he showed me the ropes, or I tried it myself on my own. And we'll talk about the pros and cons of all those approaches. Commonly requested topics for us to cover tonight included formation basics, formation safety, training, and maintaining position and speed. And this information from the survey will help us guide the discussion, so thank you so much for participating in the pre-show survey. All right, gentlemen, where would you like to start?
Well, let's start with the basics.
Great.
Why do we fly formation?
Right.
Well, first of all, because it's a heck of a lot of fun. Aside from that, it's a skill set unlike anything you've ever done before in your life. Because it's not a solo skill, it involves two, three, four, and as many more airplanes as you put together in a formation. It requires a lot of teamwork, and the end result at the end of the day, of course, is a lot of camaraderie. It's an extremely dynamic environment, requires extreme precision and skill, and at the end of the day, improves your flying skills.
Right, and I would just add that it's like the skills themselves aren't terribly hard to learn. They come pretty quick, but the mindset is different. It's as you said, it's teamwork, and it's so different from the flying that we're taught as in our regular courses, because that is all independent, self-reliant, pilot in command. You make all the decisions for yourself and for your aircraft. But it's different in formation flying, where you have an assigned role as part of a group.
Yep.
So much for, in its entirety, that notion of PIC is the final authority.
Well, when you're flying as a wingman, you basically surrender your authority to the flight leader. So in that sense, yes.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's not a democracy. It's not like you all vote. You have very, very assigned, clearly assigned tasks.
And we'll talk about how we determine those tasks and implement them as far as the planning process in a little bit.
Sure, and of course it takes a tremendous amount of trust. You've got to trust the people you're flying with, because after all, you're in very close proximity to them.
Right, and that trust is earned.
So yeah. I'm picky about who I let in the airplane with me. Sounds like I should be even pickier in this scenario.
Well, that's one of the responsibilities of the flight leaders to choose who will fly in that any given formation.
Mm-hmm. All right, so the way we're going to play it this evening is we have a number of slides with the different facets that we want to discuss. And what we're going to do is we're going to jump back and forth a little bit. We're going to cover a slide with some information, and then we're going to insert a video to sort of, you know, talk about the flow from beginning to end of what a formation flight looks like, and then we'll jump back and cover more slide information. So we're going to start with a video showing us a formation takeoff, I believe.
So this is the formation takeoff that Dave and I made. This particular takeoff is an element or two-ship formation takeoff. There are a number of ways to get a formation airborne. You can take off single ship and then rejoin in the air, or in this instance, you can take off as a unit, as a two ship.
Right, and it is a unit. You're trying to think and act almost as one, mm-hmm. and ATC treats you as one.
And the two ship is, in fact, the fundamental building block of all formations.
And we'll get a little more into the benefits both for the pilots and the and ATC as far as operating as a multi-aircraft unit in a little while. Okay, good. All right, give me a little bit of background on formation flying.
Well, formation originally originated back in World War II back in the early days with the World War I pilots flying over enemy lines, doing reconnaissance and that sort of thing, and they found that when they launched two aircraft together in formation and they could provide mutual coverage and look out for one another, that it was a much more successful operation than when they went out single ship. So those are the origins.
And fortunately for us, when we're doing our photo missions here at AOPA, they're typically photography flights. So photos, videos, we're trying to get great pictures of airplanes. But still, that mutual support aspect exists, where if one has a problem, you can, you know, the other can assist, and it's really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a couple of different ways you can employ formation once you gain the skills. As Dave said, we do primarily here. Well, Dave and I fly formation a lot just for fun, but for AOPA, we fly primarily in photoship formations. So then that also has a different element to it, because we fly mostly dissimilar airplanes as opposed to similar airplanes, so that ups the ante a bit.
Right.
And the station keeping is different, because the photographer is asking you to maintain different positions relative to the camera ship. So it's, you know, you're getting instructions like move 3 feet out, hold that, move 3 feet in, hold that, move 3 feet down, hold that, move 1 feet up, 1 foot up, hold that. And
right.
So it's a bit more challenging and a little bit different.
Right.
And then the other aspect of formation flying, or another way to employ formation flying, is in air shows, as you see at Sun and Fun, Oshkosh, and other events.
Right. And we've both done some air show flying, and that's a little bit different, is it? Because it's the emphasis is on display and proximity to the crowd and showing off the certain elements of the airplanes. But it's all built on the same sort of fundamental building blocks, and the same skills that you develop in a two-ship formation are the basis for the photography and the airshow flying.
Okay. So, Mike, you mentioned station keeping. I think that's going to be our next video here.
It
Let's
is.
Take a look at it.
Yes, it is. So here we have a standard fingertip formation in a little turn. Dave is stacked up, so he's maintaining the same references throughout the maneuver. And if we were to roll wings level or roll into a right turn, then he would maintain those exact same position, those same references throughout the maneuver. It's as if the two airplanes were welded together. Mm-hmm. And what you'll see in this video and other videos that you'll see that come up is that it appears that the flight leader is frozen in the sky because the two airplanes are welded together. And everything in the background, the earth in the background, is moving, is constantly cycling, constantly moving.
Mm-hmm. So in that position, as opposed to the two airplanes, the lead and the wingman operating like this, what you're really talking about is them operating like this.
Right.
Okay.
Right, and the wing pilot really has, it's just solely concentrated on the lead. And so it's easy to lose track of the airplane's attitude and its orientation and where it is, what sort of airspace it is, because the wing pilot just doesn't care. The wing pilot is thinking solely about maintaining the proper position.
So it's the lead pilot's responsibility to make sure that we're doing everything we should and nothing that we shouldn't.
Exactly.
As far as attitude, location, you name it.
Right.
Exactly.
And that's where the trust comes in, mm-hmm. because you know, the wing pilot might have total vertigo. You have no idea whether the plane's pointed up or down. you're just there to hold station, mm-hmm. and that's your sole focus. And if the wing pilot takes his mind off that aspect and starts thinking about the navigation or the communication or other aspects of the flight, he's probably not going to do his primary job very well. So it's a sort of mental self-discipline to force yourself to do your job and only your job and do it to the very best of your ability.
Yeah, I've been in that exact same position, the same position that Dave's talking about, flying formation over the water, mm-hmm. on a hazy day in the summertime, where there's no horizon reference, no reference of up or down. It was, I had no idea, and not a clue what our attitude was. I just knew I had to hang in there.
Right.
So we've mentioned a little bit about how there's a little bit of a change in mental process and responsibility as far as, for example, the wingman giving up some control. So conversely, that lead pilot is assuming an enormous amount of responsibility, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And what is that wingman doing most of the time? Where is he or she looking? What is he or she doing? Let's say they're just station keeping. What?
Well, any wing pilot is always correcting back to position. I mean, mm-hmm. we have standard references that we use in the RV community. There are standard references we use for the bearing line, which is the position, the reference line off of lead. We use the outer aileron hinge lined up with the spinner. That's the bearing line reference. So the wingman's job is to stay in position, so he or she is constantly referencing that and using throttle and stick to maintain that position.
Right. And there's not a lot of black and white. Yeah. It is black and white. There's not a lot of interpretation involved. It's either those points are lined up or they're not. And if they're not, you've got to constantly work your way back in to where they are. So it's a constant struggle to get in position and stay there.
I think at one point one of you said to me that that wing pilot is spending 99% of their time out of position trying to get back in position. And the better they are, the less those distances are.
The wingman is always working to maintain position. And the difference between a really good wingman and one that's, say, a novice or someone that's new is the really good wingman, the experienced wingman, is just maybe a centimeter out of position and correcting back, whereas the student is 3 feet or more out and correcting back. So
one of our chat respondents said something, and I think I can interpret what he meant. Dan Wilkins said, 3 feet, ? And I think he's saying, you're measuring by such a small amount, and now you're saying centimeters.
Well, out of position.
Yeah, yeah.
Out of position.
Yeah,
but
right.
In terms of our distance away from the aircraft in formation, typically in close formation, we talk about lateral separation of 2 to 4 feet is the standard.
Mm-hmm.
So, you're offset back because you're in fingertip. But if you were to be line abreast, the wingtips would be 2 to 4 feet apart. That's
wow.
that's considered the standard.
It's considered normal.
That's considered normal, yeah.
All right, so let's move into a little discussion of what formation flying is and what formation flying is not.
Well, formation flying is, first of all, it's a pre-briefed event. It's flying however many airplanes are involved, it's flying as a single entity. There's a flight leader, and his responsibility is for all the planning and execution of the flight. And then the wingman, their job is to maintain position. Each flight member of the flight has an assigned role, of course, the flight leader, and then the number two ship, number three ship, number four ship, and so on. Of course, as we said earlier, we're operating in close proximity to one another. There's a clear purpose. We brief a plan, and we fly the plan, Most of our flying is done, if we're not doing air show stuff or if we're not doing missing man formations or flyovers of some kind of event or photo work, then most of the time we're out flying, because the one thing about formation is that it's a perishable skill. Mm. So you have to constantly fly to maintain that skill. Mm. And if you go for a couple of weeks without flying, when you get back in the air, you can tell that you're rusty. So that's pretty much what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And do you want to go jump into what formation flying is not, or we're going to look at
I think we have a clip.
We've got a clip first.
Okay.
It's a break and rejoin.
Okay, so this is typical of a break out or pitch out and rejoin. So the number one ship is, and this is a turning right turning rejoin you see here. So the number two ship is coming up the bearing line, in on the bearing line, and then closing in on the normal position. Here's another break, pitch out, and here's an outside rejoin. So in this case, we're practicing rejoining to the outside of the turn circle.
And the rejoins are really one of the most dynamic, the quickest changing, and one of the more difficult skills to learn in formation flying. The airplanes are going the same speed, but they separate. And then they close, and the rate of separation, then the rate of closure can be pretty dramatic at the time that it's happening. Remember, these are wide angle pictures that we're watching, and
right.
The lead airplane goes from a speck on the windshield to filling the windshield in a hurry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no question. Dave's exactly right. When it comes to formation training and formation skill. The pitch out and rejoin is the most difficult of all the skill sets, and it takes the longest time to master.
Mm-hmm. And you know, when you watch some of the really great formation teams, you know, the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds, it's really fun to watch not just what happens in the show line in front where they're making their passes, but to look behind and to see how they do their rejoins and how they bring these airplanes from widely separated to right together in just a very short amount of time.
Oh, Dave, you can elaborate on framing that notion you mentioned earlier, I think. You can tell who the people are that do fly formation, right?
Sure, because they're watching the rejoins, because right. The rejoins are really the hardest part to choreograph. Mm-hmm. You know, once the airplanes are in formation, and then they have some just very small, subtle movements to get exactly where they want to be, but when they're miles apart and they're trying to close the distance in the shortest amount of time, you see that's where the real skill comes in. Uh-huh. You know, you see them. I'm amazed when I watch some of these formation teams at how they're able to do it. It just seems impossible.
And sometimes that's the stuff that's happening behind your head, or often behind your head, but maybe beyond the line of sight or below the trees. But that's where the backstage magic is happening.
Exactly.
Is what you're saying, basically.
Sure.
So one of the things that struck me as I started to poke and prod around a little bit and learn a little about formation flying when I sat in on a ground school that you taught, Mike, is. You know, we pilots, we like lots of lingo, we like lots of acronyms, and they're necessary, and you know, but I was struck by the fact that when it comes to getting initiated with formation terminology, it's a whole new set of words and verbs and nouns that you may never have heard before. So in order to make sure we try to cover all those, you had mentioned bearing line when we were looking at our join mm-hmm. and rejoin
yep.
video. Can you define that for us?
Well, bearing line is just a reference line that we use to maintain a position on another aircraft. So it's normally, the bearing line is measured from the tip of the lead aircraft, and then the angle line, typically is in the 30 to 45 degree range.
Back from the wing.
Mm-hmm. So that's the angle. And if you had diagrammed the bearing line, it would be from the spinner tip to the spinner tip of the number two airplane. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the bearing line. But when you're on the bearing line, you have different references you use, eyeball to airplane, to figure out exactly what's going to place you on that bearing line.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we talked a little bit about what formation flying is as far as having a common purpose and planning ahead. Tell me what formation flying is not. What's a fallacy there?
Well, it's not a pickup game. You know, it's not just a game of catch as catch can, and it's not just, hey, we'll all meet in the run up area, and whoever gets there first is the lead. You know, that's an invitation to problems, and you'll often see with a group of pilots who are going somewhere, they'll say, all right, who's experienced in formation? And some people will say that they are, and then somebody who might not be, they'll say, okay, great, we'll put that person as the lead, mm-hmm. and then the rest of us will fly off their wing. And that is just an invitation to disaster. You know, I mean, it's the lead pilot should really be the most experienced. And you're just setting up for failure when you put somebody who's not well versed in this as the lead pilot, because mm-hmm. what happens is that the other pilots will try to fly the formation from the wing, and that just doesn't work. You know, they're trying to it's like the lead is the one who's really flying all the planes in the formation. That's got to be the most experienced pilot, or at least an experienced pilot. You could give a pilot of lesser experience some practice flying the lead, but please don't put somebody who's inexperienced or has never done it before in the lead position, because it invites confusion.
Mm. Yeah, it just makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up when I think about it.
And to that end, that might lead people into thinking, okay, fine, Dave, well then how do I get started? We'll cover that shortly. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's move on to our next clip. I think it's cross under.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this is just a demonstration of a cross under. In this case, the number two airplane is moving from the left wing down behind, and then back up on the right wing. And there's a number of reasons why we do cross unders. It may be because the sun angle is such that on the starboard, on the left wing, the sun is in the eyes of the wingman, so a good leader, flight leader, would direct him, give him the signal to cross to the other side so that the sun is behind him instead of him looking into him, burning his retinas out. Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing how just a 1 or 2 degree heading change makes that cross under happen. I mean, it's a subtle maneuver, and it's amazing how quickly it takes place, even with just the most minor control inputs.
Yeah, it's a deliberate move to the opposite side. It's not a race to the other side. It's very important that you do it slowly, deliberately, and precisely.
All right, so tell me about the airplanes that you would ideally like to plug into a formation flight.
Well, you know, any airplane can be flown in formation. And those of you who are watching may have seen, or if you haven't, you can Google it, the Airbus formation, where they have the Airbus airliners in formation. It's a really fantastic, very cool, well-orchestrated formation. But obviously, airliners are not the best airplanes for flying formation. The ideal airplane for flying formation is a low-wing, bubble canopy, tandem seat or single seat on the centerline airplane, because that gives you maximum visibility in all directions. By being on the center line, you have the same references looking left or right, no matter what wing you're on. And by having the low wing, you have good visibility for all the maneuvers. Mm-hmm. And most of the airplanes we're talking about, whether it's an RV or some of the warbirds like the Yaks and the Nanchangs, they all are also very maneuverable airplanes, which is a big advantage in flying formation.
Mm-hmm. Right, and also non-vernier throttles was on there, and that may seem esoteric, but it's a big one, because you know you're constantly making throttle changes, sometimes pretty abrupt throttle changes, and if you've got a vernier style throttle, that's can be impossible to do. So you know, the vernier throttle in some cases for some formation groups is a disqualifier. You can't fly with us if you've got a vernier throttle.
Yeah, I can just imagine.
Yeah, how quickly can you twist? It's right. It's not fast enough.
Right. All right. So let's take a look at another video. We're going to move on to close trail.
Okay, so this is an example of a close trail. In this situation, the number two aircraft is a dead at 6 o'clock. And it's hard to tell in this because, as Dave said, this is wide angle lens, but you're actually approximately one ship length behind the aircraft in front. And again, every position that we have in formation, whether it's fingertip or close trail, we have defined references, and those references differ from airplane to airplane, of course, because a reference you might use in the RV community would be different than you would use in the Nanchang or Rack, Yak or Warbird community. Mm-hmm. Every airplane has its own ideal references.
Gotcha. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about plan the flight and then fly the plan as a practice. However, let's talk briefly about the regulatory notions.
Well, as far as regulation goes, if you're going to go out and fly formation, first of all, let me just state that if you're going to go out and fly formation, there is no credential to fly formation.
Like if you and I just want to up and do it.
If we want to go out and practice in the local area here from Frederick, right. We can just go out and fly formation.
Okay.
We do have to pre-brief it. Common carriage is not allowed, so we can't take anybody flying with us for hire.
Yep.
We can't transport goods or persons for hire.
Yep.
But where the credential comes in is in the air show environment. So if you're going to fly in what they call wavered airspace is airspace that the FAA has designated where they've waived some of the...
Like minimum safe altitudes.
Some of the FARs are waived, like minimum safe altitudes and all that sort of thing. Then you have to have a formation credential. And those credentials are issued by FAS, the Formation Safety Team, by ICAS, the International Council of Air Shows, and Formation Flying Inc., FFI, also issues formation credentials.
Mm-hmm. So presumably that's another card that both of you are carrying around in your wallet.
Indeed we do.
Excellent, all right. Let's go on to the next video. We're gonna take a look at loose trail now.
Okay. The label is loose trail here, but the proper term is extended trail. This is an exercise in lead and lag. By lead, I mean the lead airplane is always presenting you with a curve to work with. By lead, I mean your position, your nose position in front of lead circle, turn circle, if you want to gain on him, sort of like leading a clay pigeon when you're shooting. And if you want to lag, then you position your nose position outside the leader's turn circle, and that'll give you more distance between you and the airplane ahead.
And Mike's got such a lead foot and a fast airplane that I'm always trying to lead with him. I'm trying to cut off the angle so that I can stay close enough.
You're always trying to aim ahead of him.
Exactly.
What you're saying, which requires a little bit of being psychic as far as what's he going to do next.
It's like throwing a pass in football. You throw it to where the receiver is going to be, not where they are.
Right.
Yeah, and I do want to point out that Dave and I have been flying formation for, 15 years or more together? Back when I had an Nanchang and you had an RV4.
It's been that long?
It's been a long time. Maybe it just seems that way. Mm-hmm. And then I had a Globe Swift and you had an RV, and I guess the latest iteration is I had an RV4 and you have an RV8.
Right.
So we've been flying together a lot, so the extended trail that you saw in that clip is extremely aggressive. And that's not typical that is absolutely not typical of a training mission. You go out and doing rolls like
it
that.
It looked to me like Dave was trying to switch to guns and
yeah,
get in for the kill.
It did have that dogfight aspect to it, yes.
All right, Mike, you mentioned a few of the organizations. We've got a slide that lists them. Let's make sure we hit them all there with flyfast.org, FFI.
That's Formation and Safety Training, mm-hmm. And there's the website, FFI, Formation Flying Inc., ICAS, International Council of Air Shows. The Red Star Pilots Association is a signatory member of FAST. There are approximately 15 signatories at this date. And that varies from my association, the Red Star Pilots Association, to the T-34 Association, North American Trainer Association, the Swift Formation Committee, the Steerman Flight. So there's a whole host of normally aircraft-specific signatories, but some signatories also allow other airplanes into their fold.
And I think it's worth mentioning we have two magazine, well-versed magazine, experts here besides Dave and all his involvement with AOPA and others. Of course, Mike, you were also involved in the Red Star magazine, I believe, mm-hmm. as well, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Now, Mike, you've been to a lot of these different formation clinics that have been put on by a bunch of these different organizations. How similar are their practices, and what are the biggest differences?
Well, in theory, the standard, the FAST standard, it should be the same throughout all the signatories. The only differences that come in are airplane specific. So obviously, a Stearman would have different references than a Swift or a T-34 or any of the other airplanes. So there are specific things to a particular airplane type, but as far as the protocols, as hand signals, radio signals, aircraft signals, those are all standard across the board.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, let's move on to our next clip. I think we're going to move into echelon formation here.
Echelon is just a different way to turn. Instead of stacking up, the number two airplane rolls on the same plane as the leader. And as you can see here, instead of being stacked up high, you can see that the leader's spinner is more or less on the horizon there, and that's the way it should be. And if you're in a four ship, all the airplanes would be on that same plane, mm-hmm. two, three, four, as opposed to being stacked up here, and then three and four stacked on this side in a fingertip.
Gotcha. Okay, so we saw a few of the groups that we could check out online, but beyond going to their website, how do I get started in learning how to fly formation?
Well, the unique thing about flying formation, of course, you need at least two airplanes. So ideally, if you're just want to get together and learn formation and you have another like-minded soul who wants to go out and do this, the ideal situation is get two airplanes, similar airplanes, compatible airplanes, and two instructors. And then you can have an instructor in each airplane with a student, and one student can get some wing time while the other observes in the lead position, and then you do a lead change, and the second student gets training.
I was just going to say that you can also there's a tremendous amount of reading material that you can use to prepare yourself. The organizations all have manuals and operating handbooks on how they fly and how they run their clinics. And then the very best thing to do is to prepare yourself by reading everything you can get your hands on, practicing, as Mike said, if compatible airplanes and instructors are available, and then attending these clinics. And they're just a great place to learn. They're very demanding, but they're a lot of fun too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we typically run, the different FAST organizations, the signatories, typically run clinics throughout the summer flying season, more or less, throughout the whole country. So we have, for instance, we have a big clinic in Porterville, California on the West Coast.
Right.
And we sometimes have 60, 70 airplanes that show up.
Wow.
And it's a clinic that runs from Thursday through Sunday, so it's a nice long clinic. But our expectation is when you come to that clinic is that you've already read the formation manual. The Red Star formation manual is probably one of the most comprehensive training manuals out there. Mm-hmm. It's 9 chapters long. It has everything in there you need to understand formation as a wingman. And the expectation is you'll come to the clinic having read the manual, and then you'll start the practical, the flight training.
Now, while the answer to this question or notion isn't necessarily the one that everyone might like to hear, I have to ask, like I did when we were talking earlier, are these clinics something where I can show up and rent an airplane?
No. You may be partners in an airplane, or you may talk to somebody who's foolish enough to lend you an airplane to go fly formation. Uh-huh. It won't be me. Mm-hmm. But typically, you bring your own airplane to the clinic.
Okay.
And the clinic, it's like any other building block approach. You start out in two ship, you learn the very basics like station keeping, the cross unders, mm-hmm. and you progress to the most difficult of the maneuvers as we discussed, the rejoins. And then once you've mastered, you've become proficient two ship, then you move on to three, four ship, mm-hmm. three and four ship training. Because there's a huge difference in dynamics, dynamic difference between a two ship and a four ship.
And once you get good at that, then you can, you can become a lead pilot and a check pilot after that. So there's a long hill to climb.
Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you can also participate in mass formations, like as we do at Sun and Fun, Oshkosh, where you're flying in 10, 15, 20 ship formations.
Right, and really one of the most rewarding things on a personal level to do is that is, you know, we'll do like tribute flights to fallen pilots, and you know, it's these missing man formations, and it's such a great tribute, and the, you know, it's the families always appreciate it. It's a sort of an honor and a respect that they'll never forget.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, there are formation groups throughout the whole country, and routinely they're called upon to do missing man formations for someone who's passed.
And just to, you know, toot the horn for you, gentlemen, you've both done that around here.
Oh yeah.
Frequently. Mm-hmm. And
yeah. Yep.
And it's an honor. It's an honor to be asked, and it's an honor to participate.
Yep. Mm-hmm. All right, let's move on to our next clip. I think next we're going to cover a landing scenario.
This is one way to recover a formation. In this case, we're doing a two-ship element landing.
This is right here at our home airport at Frederick, and the wing pilot is not looking at the normal, looking down the runway and judging height above the ground in the normal way. The wing pilot is watching the lead pilot just as the wing pilot does any time they're flying.
Wow. So to the extent that the wing pilot is assuming that I'm going to land on pavement by virtue of their position with respect to the lead pilot.
Oh yeah. I mean, right. First of all, you're not going to land on a 60-foot wide runway in formation. It's going to be a runway that can accommodate a two-ship formation mm-hmm, landing. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at 75 feet for somebody who's really proficient. 100 feet or more for students mm-hmm. for a formation landing. But Dave's right. I mean, your focus is on the leader, and you, of course, you see the runway environment in your peripheral vision, mm-hmm. and you can see as you come in, get low to the runway, you can see the pavement, but your focus is on the leader.
Right, and the lead pilot is essentially flying both airplanes because he'll typically, as you saw with that video of Mike, you know, he gives you a nice long time in ground effect, and isn't doing anything abrupt, and makes it easy to fly the wing.
So one of the other things besides giving up control that I would have to rewire my brain for, another is lack of center line after being beat into my head mm-hmm. for all those years, you know, commercial training and whatnot.
Well, sure. Well, let's face it. Throughout all of our training, we're taught to avoid other airplanes. You know, if you see another airplane, take evasive action. Mm-hmm. And now you enter into formation training. We're teaching you just the opposite.
Exactly. And you're taught to be independent and self-reliant. And here, it's just a total turnabout because you're depending on each other.
All right, so we talked a little bit about how we could get started finding some clinics. How long is it going to take me to get my chops sharp?
Well, you know, it really depends, Ferdy, on your background, your experience, and your...
So in my case, a long time is what
you're
saying.
Yeah, yeah. In your case, years. you know, if you come out of the military background and you have recent formation experience, then, of course, the learning curve is much easier. If you're starting from scratch with no formation experience, it could take a long time. And you know, you can't come to even a four-day clinic like the one we have in Porterville, California, with the expectation that you're going to walk in the door a novice on day one and walk out as a qualified formation pilot on day four. It's a very unique skill set. It takes a lot of practice, a lot of discipline, and mm-hmm. it's not going to happen in 4 days mm-hmm. for a novice.
Right, and there are some key differences too, because most of us, you know, civilian private pilots, we're not used to being criticized for our flying. Mm. You know, it's like instructors.
Type A, I'm always right.
Well, but it's like instructors, it's in the instructor handbook that it's like they're supposed to compliment you, tell you how well you're doing, keep encouraging you.
I don't think I read that page.
But when you get to, it's a kind of harsh reality when you get to these formation clinics and you're flying with others mm-hmm. and they're depending on you and they will criticize you very, you know, candidly, you know, about exactly what you did wrong, exactly how you're falling short, mm-hmm. and it's not always easy to hear. So it's not
private. I mean, we didn't touch on this, but there's the two of the most important aspects of a formation flight are the briefing in the beginning, mm-hmm. where you brief the plan and fly the plan, and everybody's roles are assigned. But a real critical aspect of it is what Dave is talking about, which is the debriefing. Mm. And it's a public event.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and it can be fairly bruising. And you know, you've got to check your ego at the door, because it's different from the pats on the head that you've probably received during your civilian flight training to date. And these are pilots who you probably respect, who you want to make a favorable impression, and they are going to be harshly critical, and they were going to bring up every shortcoming. And it's easy to take that personally, and you really have to develop a thick skin to get past it, because to achieve what you want to achieve in this, it's a team exercise, and you've got to take those criticisms to heart. You've got to improve, and you've got to show an attitude that makes people want to trust and fly with you.
Sure, and we the objective in a debrief is not to humiliate a pilot. The whole objective is to make it a learning experience for everyone. So we follow the what, why, how drill, which means what happened, why did it happen, and how do you fix it? Mm-hmm. So, in revealing those things, as Dave said, it can be pretty bruising to be told you screwed this up, and this is how you can fix it.
Right, and after you screwed that up, you screwed up the next three things too. And
I'm not done yet.
And the horse you rode in on, and it's not easy to hear sometimes. But you've got to, but it's like it's a learning experience, and the surprising aspect is how much fun it is, because it's as you see yourself progress, as you master these new skills, you feel really good about it. Yeah. And it can be quite rewarding. So even though it can be a long and fairly arduous process, it's a really a never ending process, because even when you feel like you've got the basics down, there's always ways to improve. Mm-hmm. So even though it may take a long time, it's a worthy investment of your time and effort.
And if it's any consolation, not only are you being criticized, but everybody else in the flight's being criticized. So that's part of the whole, the camaraderie and the team experience.
So we talked a bit about the debrief. We haven't spent much time on the pre-flight brief. Personally, I was rather shocked the first time I sat in on one. You ran it, Mike, for a formation pre-flight briefing. How serious the tone was. And it wasn't until I stepped through the entire process of going along for the flight and the debrief that I realized, A, those guys and gals weren't messing around when they were being serious in the brief, and B, it was entirely appropriate.
Well, we call it serious fun.
Yeah.
We're all there to have fun. I mean, we're not going to war. Mm-hmm. We're doing this because we want to learn a skill and we want to have fun. But if you're flying 2 to 4 feet away from somebody, you better take it seriously.
Right, and the brief is the place that sets the tone for the whole flight, mm-hmm. and it's where your understandings have got to align, because that's the place to iron it all out, to ask the questions, and to really figure out exactly what you're going to do, and if you do that properly, it's such an essential part of a successful flight that it's really hard to overemphasize.
Yeah, the potential for miscommunication in a warship formation is great. So it's important, when we say brief the plan, fly the plan, it's important to have a sequence of events and execute that sequence of events exactly as you briefed it. That just helps to cut down on any possibility of confusion.
We'll move into communication in a moment, but first I've got a question. It's semi-related to where we are right now. As far as, brief the plan, fly the plan, well, what if something happens? How do you continue with the plan or not? So Princess Pilot asks, what if a formation flight encounters another aircraft that's not part of the formation?
Well, we talked about mutual support. That's one of the reasons that the origins of formation flight developed. Mm-hmm. In addition to the wingman, in addition to maintaining position on lead, they're also looking beyond lead, and if they see traffic that's impinging on the practice area, then we have standard protocols, standard procedures to follow for avoidance. Uh-huh. If the flight leader sees an intruder, then he's going to stop maneuvering. And he's going to maneuver the flight away from the intruder. If a wingman sees the intruder and it's a threat to the flight, then there is a formation communication protocol. You know, the wingman would call knock it off, mm-hmm. and all maneuvering would stop, and then he'd report what the reason for the knock it off was.
Mm-hmm. And part of the plan is to cover what happens when things don't go according to plan. You know, if somebody has a radio failure, if somebody has to divert, if somebody has a mechanical problem.
Sure.
You know, these are all things that come up from time to time, and you cover those in the briefing so that if they happen in real life, it's part of the plan, even when things aren't going according to plan.
Well put.
And I want to add that all these protocols we're talking about are outlined in detail in the formation manual. Mm-hmm. The knock-it-off procedures are detailed. Lost sight procedures, if you lose sight of the in formation. Mm-hmm. Everything is covered in the formation manual. So you should have a fairly good awareness of all that stuff before you come to fly the first time.
Okay, great. Let's get into a little more detail with communication, as you mentioned.
Well, in formation, there's three ways to communicate. There are hand signals, as you see in the slide here. Got Duke Multer giving a hand signal. In the left slide, he's got a single fist raised. That's a signal for an aircraft on his right wing to move to the other side, the cross under that we observed earlier. Mm-hmm. The double pump you see in the right, that's a signal for, in this case, an element, the number 3 and 4 aircraft on the right wing to move to the other side. So that's an example of a hand signal. There are also aircraft signals. Duke could accomplish the same thing by using a wing dip, so he's just dipping the aircraft wing mm-hmm. in the direction he wants the airplane to move. In the case of the wing dip, it applies to the aircraft immediately adjacent to the lead, and it's an indication of which direction to go. So that's an example of an aircraft signal, and there are others. And then, of course, the last and not least is a radio call. When all else fails, you can make a radio call. Mm-hmm.
And you can also reinforce with right. with a hand signal and a radio call, or a hand signal and an aircraft movement. So that's then and when you know you're flying with new formation pilots, it's a good idea to you know to use multiple ways to communicate the same point, and then that helps them. It just reinforces in their own minds that when he makes that wing dip, that means cross under. You know, so it's. When he makes that bent arm movement, same thing.
You know, there are legitimate reasons that instances where a wingman would not be able to see a signal. For instance, if the sun angle were such and there's a glare on the canopy, mm-hmm. you can stick your hand up there all day long, but the wingman's not going to be able to see it because of the shine on the canopy.
Right. So I mentioned earlier that I was surprised that there are new words in the formation flying arena that I hadn't come across before. Let's look at some of those.
Sure. These are typical formation terms, station keeping, echelon is a configuration of a formation. The cross under you've observed, close trail you've observed, the pitch out you looked at, and there's many, many, many more.
Right.
My advice is dig into the formation manual, learn them all before you come to a clinic.
Yeah, because otherwise you might hear, you're sucked. And it's like, hey, you're insulting me somehow.
Right.
It's like, you're acute.
Right.
You know, it's like that has a.
Right.
You're not complimenting me on my looks. There's a very specific message you're trying to get through.
It's all part of the communication process. Mm-hmm. Very important information.
Mm-hmm. In my ground school, I like to tell new pilots, you're going to love it and you're going to hate it. I'm going to use all sorts of words that you've never heard before, and you're going to be frustrated when I don't stop to define them. But eventually, they'll be your vernacular too, mm-hmm. and you'll throw them around, and other people will look at you like, what do those words mean?
Sure.
It's just part of the process.
Every skill set has a language.
Right. So we talked a little bit about air show. When Mike and Dave go out and fly formation, are they putting on an air show? Are you doing the same things I would see on the flight line at Oshkosh and Sun and Fun? How do they relate?
In this case, the slide you see here is that's a four-ship formation with smoke on in a close trail.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's something we would certainly do in the practice area for fun, mm-hmm. but it's also obviously something you would do at an air show. So yes, I mean the skill sets you learn in practice are the same skills that you would apply in air show flying.
building block notion, is what I'm hearing.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the difference is we're doing them at altitude. We're not trying to make a displaying for an audience. We're just sharpening our own skills primarily.
Yeah, when Dave and I go out and fly here locally, we go, you know, we clip typically fly between 3,500 feet and 6,000 or 7,000 feet. If you're in an air show environment, you know, you're down low.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Looks like we're about at the end here. We do have a question, and I don't know if you gentlemen are have the experience to help with this question.
No. Let's see.
Chuck asks, all of this is interesting, but all of my formation experience is in rotorcraft helicopter. Will you be discussing trail formation, rotor wash issues, and lead/wingman counter-rotating rotor blades?
Well, there's no question that flying formation rotorcraft is completely different. I mean, the concepts are the same, but as he has pointed out, there's rotor wash issues, there's all kinds of other issues. And I don't have any experience flying in flying formation rotorcraft.
Mm-hmm. Me neither.
Fair enough. The closest I ever came to a helicopter in the pattern was we were landing on separate runways, and I was shocked by the downdraft because mm-hmm. I was landing too close in time.
Sure. Mm.
To when the other helicopter came.
Well, it can
by.
Be done. I mean, it's done in the Army all the time. And I have friends who are ex helicopter pilots from their Army days who flew it all the time.
Mm-hmm. So I admire what they do. I have no understanding of it.
All right. Let's see. Cindy made a great comment when we watched our landing video. Where we were looking from Dave's airplane to Mike's, and we were seeing Mike's airplane land left of center. Cindy said, "I knew I always landed left of center for a reason." So we've got a lead pilot.
There we go.
In the wings.
Right. There we go.
Right there. No pun intended.
She's got that part mastered already.
Right. There was another question here. Let's see.
I've got a question for Mike.
I'm
always curious about which groups require parachutes, helmets, Nomex flight suits. Each organization seems a little bit different. What have you observed in that area? And are parachutes, helmets, and Nomex flight suits a good idea?
I think they're definitely a good idea. Since you know it's all about risk mitigation, of course. Mm-hmm. So if you're in a higher risk environment, formation certainly is a higher risk environment. I mean, I personally wear a helmet, I wear a Nomex flight suit, and I wear a parachute. Of course, if you have a passenger and you're in formation and you're going to do any aerobatics, you by regulation you have to have a parachute on. But aside from that, most of the signatories make the option of whether you wear safety equipment or not your choice.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody mandates that, but of course. As I said, it's all about risk mitigation.
Right, and you know, I own a helmet and a flight suit and a parachute too, but really in our photography flying, we seldom, if ever, wear them because you know we want to. First of all, there's not any real practical way to get out of the airplane,
yeah.
But also there's a you know if you're showing a beach baron, you're gonna fly that in the manner in which it's meant. To be flown, and it's not necessarily with a helmet and a parachute.
Mm-hmm. Nor necessarily 30 up or down or 60 side to side.
Oh well, that's true for the. I mean, you're not. But I'm just thinking of a like emergency use
right.
parachute in case the two airplanes hit.
Right.
But yeah, that's. I'm always curious about the parachute use in particular because I think it's a great idea to have one as well.
All right. J.W. Schrag wants to know, how close to the lead aircraft do you recommend to be for beginner wing pilot training?
Well,
is that something you adjust as you get more proficient?
Well, it's what I call the new guy dilemma, because actually when you're flying in formation, when you're tucked in close, it's easier to fly formation because As the flight leader turns, your motion, your relative motion, is relatively small.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you have to, in a left turning rejoin, you have to climb and add power, and now you're on the outside of the turn circle, so it takes more slightly faster airspeed to maintain position. If you're in close, your motion is relatively small. But if you're 10 feet out and you're trying to maintain that position, mm-hmm. then your motion is tremendous, and there's probably not enough power in the world for you to maintain position.
Right.
So that's what I call the new guy dilemma, because when you're it's very, very, very unnerving as a new formation pilot to be tucked in close, extremely unnerving. But it's actually easier to fly in close from a motion standpoint. So
interesting.
Right, and we get that in the photography flying a lot too, because you know as a wing pilot, it's your inclination to tuck in that standard sort of parade position, nice and close. Mm-hmm. But the photographer often wants you further away to get the landscape, to get the the background of that you're flying through. Mm-hmm. And so you've kind of constantly push against that inclination to want to tuck in.
Hmm. So when we work with our students, we tell them fly as close as you are comfortable. And as you get more comfortable and more proficient, they work their way in.
Got it.
Until in the end, when they're proficient, they're tucked in right where they should be.
And then just to the point where you have to say, ease off a foot.
Yeah, that does happen.
Right, and it's like there's such a thing. I mean, it's like there's such a thing as flying too close.
Sure,
absolutely.
And it's like there's a proper position, and you can be too far away, and you can be too close, and you're just as wrong when you're too close as you are when you're too far away.
Yeah, if you have wingtip overlap, then you're too close.
Yeah. So J.W. Schrag, who asked that question that we just started on, said responded now and said, well stated and exactly as I had thought and heard. Closer is easier, but all caps, definitely unnerving.
Unnerving, no question about it.
John Bennett asks us, is there a special technique or change in procedure when the air is rough or choppy?
A lot of pilots tend to fly slightly looser when it's real bumpy because the potential for bumping into another aircraft is greater. Mm-hmm. It's just more challenging because you're constantly really, really fighting to stay in position, and the bumps are constantly fighting to throw you out of position, so
right.
it's a lot more fatiguing mm-hmm. to fly half an hour in bumps than it is half an hour in smooth air.
But your lead can help you out here, because if the lead is trying to fly like a constant altitude and is correcting to get to hold an altitude, that's a lot harder on the wing. Mm-hmm. If the lead will just hold a constant attitude, ride the bumps.
Just like the flight levels, riding the pressure wave.
Right.
Same sort of
then
thing.
Then it's easier on the wing pilots as well, because they can match. They have it's easier for them to match the attitude of the lead aircraft.
All right. The last thing I wanted to cover is one of you just said the word fatigue, and in our earlier discussions we had talked about how the clinics go and how many hops there might be a day and how hard it is on the pilot. Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, when you have a brand new formation pilot comes into a clinic, when they start flying, it wears them out very quickly. Mm-hmm. So my rule of thumb is with a brand new student is never fly more than 3 sorties in a given day. Because after that it becomes counterproductive. I mean, they're mentally and physically exhausted. And their brains fried, and it just doesn't work.
So. It's kind of shocking how much work flying in formation can be, mm-hmm. because you do it for 30 minutes, and sometimes you're pouring with sweat. You're just exhausted physically and mentally, and you are just putting every ounce of concentration you have into doing it correctly. And after a while, it's like any learned skill. It gets better. It gets less fatiguing. After a while, you drill it into your alligator brain, and you can, and it becomes almost second nature. It sure is unnatural at first, and it will require every ounce of concentration that you have. And for those like me and Mike sometimes that aren't terribly blessed in the concentration department, you wear out pretty quick.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen students in the dead of winter when it's cold as can be get mm-hmm. out of an airplane after a sortie just soaking wet, soaking wet.
Wow.
So.
All right, gentlemen. Thanks so much for being here and for helping to give us some of the dirty details on formation flying for our members.
It's our pleasure. Fun.
Thank you, Fernie, and enjoy the flying you do out there together. It's a blast.
Yeah, exactly. All right, and to our viewers, thanks for joining us tonight as well. If you have any questions, as part of your membership, you can contact our Pilot Information Center staff Monday through Friday at 800-USA-AOPA. That's 800-872-2672. Or you can email your questions to us at pilotassist@aopa.org. Also, please subscribe to this YouTube channel using the red subscribe button. And don't forget to check out the AOPA website for a variety of resources as well at www.aopa.org. Thanks so much. We'll see you next time.